Let's leave it there. Let's talk a little bit. You know, you've all mentioned about the med in Europe. What about Asia, guys? I mean, Asia seems to be a huge topic. And look at you, Jorge. I mean, your company, Royal Caribbean, seems to be building new ships, and they all go to Asia. So what's the future of Europe if you're putting all your big ships in Asia?
Well, I think in Europe we're going to continue seeing a healthy trend and growing slowly, but growing. Let's hope that in the East Med things get better. But definitely Asia is, and especially China, is the place now. I think everybody agrees on this, and we are seeing that in our numbers. Actually, it's not a coincidence that we, as a group, we put our most modern ship, Quantum of the Seas, in China. It's not a coincidence. We get most of our revenues from our new builds. And China, what we're seeing is that it's a tremendous market with tremendous growth opportunities, and we're quite excited. Still, I think...
Are you nervous? Because everybody's putting ships there.
Yes, that's... What?
Everybody's putting ships in China.
Well, China is such a tremendous market with such a potential that I think there's place for everyone. But what we are concerned is with the signatures.
You're concerned about your colleague next to
you? No, we're quite happy that, I mean, you know, there's space for everyone.
He's putting his big new ship there next year.
Right, no, that's terrific. But the thing that we should be careful is about the economic slowdown of China. I think there's potential for everyone, but we're quite concerned about the first signals that we're getting from the economy.
Good. Francis, maybe you want to pick up and comment. Your latest ship, congratulations, by the way, last week, Norwegian Escape was launched. I hear great things about it. You told me great things about it. A new breakaway plus class vessel. And the next breakaway plus vessel is going down to Asia.
Yeah, so we're... thank you. Escape was a fantastic launch, and I think maybe some of the people in the room actually had an opportunity to see her in Hamburg or in Southampton. But... very pleased, brand new ship coming in. So that's one of four new ships that Norwegian Cruise Line are bringing in to the market over the course of the next 5 years. So we're seeing a 40% increase in capacity just on that brand alone with the entrance of these four vessels. So, you know, one area of the market that we've not been involved in has been Asia. And whilst North America will continue to suck up some of that capacity growth, from our point of view, Norwegian are really now focusing on how do we develop the international scene. So we're getting very aggressive in terms of what we're doing. We've opened up six new offices around the world this year, three in China, one in Australia, one in Brazil. And we'll continue to build on that.
Everybody's opening new offices. I know Neil opened a new office yesterday in Japan with 75 new staff as well. So
It's exciting times for the industry, and I think, you know, we're not the only ones building new ships. I think Carlos, you talked about 46 new ships coming. So we all need to figure out what destinations we're going to be putting these new builds in. So we've announced, I think, about a month ago, a new entrance coming into China, which was going to be the next ship, which was formerly known as the List. We haven't announced the name of the new ship yet, but that will be a dedicated, purposely built ship for the Chinese market, recognizing the culture and the sensitivities that, that the Chinese guests are wanting. So that will be coming, and that's you know, the biggest ship in our fleet at that size, on the breakaway plus side. What I would like to do is also just comment about Europe, because that ship will go to China, you know, and I think there'll be more ships later on as that market grows. It's very, very a big opportunity. I think, you know, you're right, we need to be careful of not oversaturating it too early, but, you know, it's a market that is going to be clearly a great opportunity for the cruise lines, both in terms of capacity, sourcing customers, and as you mentioned, from a yield perspective too. But Europe still maintains, you know, for us, is a key important market. And it would be remiss of me not to say that Spain continues to be a hugely important market for Norwegian. And for the other two brands as well, in terms of Oceania and Region. But Norwegian is doing extremely well in Spain. And actually, Spain is the fastest growing market for next year, for 16. So I think we're really looking forward to it. We're very confident of a very strong year for Spain next year. So it clearly you know, over 5 years being on these panels, you can see that the market has now started to turn, and I'm very, very, well, cautiously optimistic that Spain will have another very strong season for us.
And I think, you know, you look outside today, I think it's 21 degrees outside here in Madrid today. It's ideal time. We used to call it winter cruising. We did a forum in Cartagena last year, you know, and we said, forget it, it's not winter cruising. It's all year round cruising here in the Med. So, you know, congratulations keeping your Norwegian epic here.
Well, I was going to say, I mean, the support of the Spanish market has really helped us make that decision last year to keep the epic here, to test it this winter.
Excellent. Carlos, from a Carnival point of view, I mean, I know, I think you can talk general sort of Carnival Corporation brands. I mean, you've got a lot of hardware down there, you've got a lot of staff, you keep announcing new joint ventures, and you're talking about China.
So, what's interesting, I just read something the other day that, you know, you see all these ships going on there, but what is the net result for the rest of the world, right? So clearly, the 46 ships coming online, eventually it'll even out in terms of where these ships go, but at least in the interim basis, you know, Carnival Cruise Line, who's always been sort of this Caribbean brand, now with two ships now going to China in 17 and 18, which we've announced, two ships already in Australia.
Are these purpose-built ships? Like
no,
ships?
No, these
these are retrofitted.
We haven't gone that route yet. Okay. But we do have our sister brands, the Princess and others, that are building ships for that market. But when you look at what China's done, specifically in the Caribbean, potentially in 17, we could have a net reduction in capacity in the Caribbean because of these moves. So just think about that. You know.
So how do you think that affects Europe? Because everyone here really wants to know about Europe.
Yeah.
But I think at the same time, people are curious about Asia. So,
right.
I mean, you're bringing your newest ship as well to the Mediterranean.
Yeah, so the Vista will be here next year in April. It'll be here for 6 months. And really excited about being back. There's a lot of people at Carnival Cruise Line that have been grumbling for a while that we haven't had a presence here. You know, clearly in 13 we had two ships here, and before that we had Breeze, but then we sort of had these 2 years of nothing. So there is a demand for it from the North American market, from our guests that want to go on a Carnival ship, a brand new Carnival ship, and want to go to Europe. So there's sort of this pent-up demand. So it's doing really well. I just hope that we make some decisions for 17 and obviously for 18. With this.
So I think we all do. Yeah, we all want more Carnival fun ships.
But you know, as a company, we're committed. I mean, we just announced a new terminal that we're going to be building in Barcelona. So at least from our perspective, we see great value in the Spanish market, specifically Barcelona, in terms of growth. So we're committed, and you know, when we put our money and we put it into the ground, the likelihood of us leaving is close to nil. So look at that as a commitment.
Talking about Barcelona, Carla, from the Port of Barcelona's view, yeah. I mean, we've seen growth again this year. I think when we were talking, there's been a big growth. I think, you know, if we just talk about Barcelona, the growth in Barcelona, you know, feels the growth for the other ports, because the 7 day or 10 day cruises from Barcelona really help out. So how do you see the future in Barcelona? Is there any capacity problems in Barcelona at the moment? Or I mean, he's building a new terminal.
No, at this moment there's no problem. For sure, we would like to have more ships during the week, rather than the weekend. But I think that we can
Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday.
That's right. But we can manage, and I think that it's good not only for Barcelona but for all the Mediterranean.
Exactly, I think it's perfect. Just talk to me a little bit about to the group about you know, our friend from Clio said that some of the local governments now are changing their mind on tourism. I live in Barcelona as well. I've been there for 12 years. I think it was a surprise to us all when the new mayor said, you know, didn't like cruise ships and emissions. And I know that you guys in Clio have worked very hard to overcome that. So, you know, can you just explain a little bit about how you and Medcruise and Port of Barcelona have worked?
Yeah, I think that we've been doing and we are doing a very close work with Clio, with our colleagues at Clio, Medcruise and Barcelona, and the Port of Barcelona, to face the problem that the new mayor put on the table, that it was a question mark on the huge quantity of cruise passengers visiting Barcelona. But I think that it was there was a misunderstanding. I think that the mayor was so she was not really aware of it. It's only words and words. So we put and we are putting on the table.
Has she been to a cruise ship?
No, not yet.
But I
don't know if
somebody out there might want to.
It isn't time to. Not yet. I think that it's little by little, first papers, and put it on the table. So we undertook in the Port of Barcelona, study about the impact of cruises on Barcelona. And I think that afterwards we will have the presentation from the professor. And also with the environment, also we are carrying out, thanks to the cruise lines, that they have helped us a lot to identify the emissions, to convince them that that it is a misunderstanding.
It makes sense.
She doesn't know really what's behind the cruise industry.
But Michael, have you got any comments on that? I mean, sitting on the little green island there, what do you think about all this?
Before I comment on that. When I look at the port infrastructure and the work that the ports are doing, and if you look at the Spanish ports on the north of Spain and northwest of Spain, from Vigo, Bilbao, all of them, and the level of investment that they're putting in, and the issue for a port, and it was the first time, and I'm delighted to hear Carlo, it was the first time I've ever heard somebody saying a guarantee, because usually the word in the cruise industry, I know that the usual word is that there's no, the only guarantee is there's no guarantee. there's considerable investment going in by all of the ports. The issue for a port, example, for me to invest in the cruise industry and to build a new berth at 10 or 12 million euro or whatever it costs, I have no guarantee. And there's a nervousness with all this talk about China and all this move of all these ships out into these markets. If I'm, as a port director, I have a decision to make. I need a return on my investment. And if I'm given the option, I've invested 10 million in a container service and I'm putting another 80 million into the container business in the next 4 or 5 years. I can get a guarantee from Container Line for the next 5 years. And every Friday morning, I have a container, a transatlantic container ship that comes into me, 200 lifts, and he's gone. And I make the same money out of that ship in 8 hours that I do per week in the year that I make out of 55 cruise ships. So that's the decision.
So you don't really like cruise ships?
Then. We love cruise ships, but it has to be. Cruise ships come with a lot of issues for all the ports. But just to take up what Herman said about port reception facilities, ports are investing an awful lot of money. In the Baltic alone, out there are 8 or 9 ports that can take grey and black water. We're coming up to the challenge of LNG. If you look at what's happening in Hamburg and looking at what's happening in Antwerp and others, and the Baltic and Stockholm and Copenhagen, and the investment in LNG power and shore power and greening, and if you look at the whole,
I knew you would jump into this, but that's the second part.
Okay. So from the basically, what I'm trying to say is that from a port investment point of view, and in the Asia market in particular, there is a nervousness in our region that because a lot of ports invested a lot of money for oil in getting the berths and getting the ports ready to take the quantum size vessels, and the next few years the ship is gone. She's gone out to China, and there's, so there is a nervousness there. So I think a greater cooperation and collaboration between the lines in looking at, and again, delighted to hear, Carlos, that you're considering port infrastructure
investment. You should have gotten a check from them, or not?
You should have brought the check, but would you?
It's free, Carl.
We're going to have a good cup of coffee
after. Can we just stop it there? I'm just saying on the screen here, is there any questions from anybody, just at this point?
Oh, there's one over there.
There's one? I can't see.
Yeah.
So, on infrastructure, does the panel agree that in order for ports to be able to visit in infrastructure, cruise lines should guarantee minimum amount of calls? So I think what they're asking in the audience is, as a port, because there's a lot of ports out there, Are you guys, from a cruise line point of view, willing to give any sort of minimum numbers to the ports?
I mean, anybody? I can tell you, from my perspective, it's depending on where it is. Where's the port? Do I need it? Is it nice to have? Or is it really a requirement that I have? The nice to haves, those are a little bit harder to get me to write a check. The needs to have are obviously a lot easier for me to write a check.
Okay. Francis, from your point of view, I know you're investing a lot now in the Caribbean, in Belize, right? How do you see Europe? So, I mean, you've got the second largest ship in the world sitting here in the Mediterranean. How do you see that?
Well, I think it's, if we go back a little bit, you know, we talked about all these new ships coming in online, so they're going to have to go somewhere. So I think without the word guarantee in any conversation, certainly from our side, it really depends on the port and the location. You know, it's really down to a combination of a couple of things. The local government working with the ports to look at investment. If it's not that, then it's private investors working with, you know, with the cruise lines to look at doing that. So, you know, we're building our own destination in Belize, a private island off the west coast there. Sorry, east coast. And we have our own private island in the Bahamas. So I think it's a combination of that. But ultimately, you know, the key ports will expand to accommodate the ships, and the bigger ships are all coming. I don't think there's any more big ships that you can really build, certainly for the rest of this decade.
He's built another Oasis class, though.
Yeah, right? But that's about the size of, I mean, it's 3,500 to 5,500 berths. I think that's probably going to be the range of the ships, in my opinion, over the course of the next 5-6 years. So I think it's more about where you are.
What about you, Helen?
I think for us at Thomson Cruise, you know, I share the sentiment that it depends where the port is and how important to it is in terms of the position on the itinerary. But I think what's happening at Thomson Cruises is that some of the issues that we're facing is driving us to look at alternative home ports. So we've turned around in Corfu now for 10 years, and that's worked very well for us. And this year we've based a ship in Dubrovnik. So again, you know, that's somewhere that's very successful, and you know, we're seeing strong customer demand. So from a smaller cruise line perspective with smaller ships, it does give us that opportunity to look at home ports where perhaps other cruise lines can't go to, and that's really valuable.
Which I think is really great for people out there. There's a lot of smaller ports right out there, and they always say, how do we get into the cruise business? And I was talking to some friends last night over the cocktails. And you know, the port of Montreal used to have 0 calls 3 years ago. Now it has 22 calls, so congratulations to them. Neil, I saw you were pointing before. Did you want to ask a question?
I was going to answer Captain McCarthy about the comment he made on the port and the cargo port.
Can we get him a mic then, Neil? Or not? But you can stand and shout, maybe. Everybody knows Neil, the president of Costa, so quite an important cruise line in the area.
I just want to say that I'm surprised about your comments, and this is fundamentally our issue as a cruise industry, because we are talking with the ports, and we know very well that ports make most of their money with the cargo ships. And the problem is that we are not talking to the tourism industry, we are not talking to the tourism bodies. I don't believe a container spends money in an hotel or in a restaurant or buy a packet of cigarettes or go and take a coffee. And this is the impact that we as a cruise line have. And we cannot compare cruise to cargo. As a port, I understand your point. But we are fundamentally in the wrong position if this is what we are discussing here.
Okay, good. I think maybe we can talk about the end. Section 2, we're going to talk about port infrastructure. Yeah, you can answer him if you can. Sure, quickly.
No, I understand they take your point. And how cruise ports are addressing this, it goes back to the fundamental issue of the European Union, and what Herman was talking about is a greater collaboration between the political and the tourism bodies in embracing what cruising is, because for the last 15-20 years the ports have been working primarily alone in driving the tourism sector. In the cruise industry, I spend 90% of my time as a tourism representative, promoting the region, promoting what the country has to offer, rather than the port. So I think in working in collaboration through ESPO, through this new DG move, through CLIA, through all of the organizations, we need to bring the tourism agenda higher up and the cruise tourism, rather than just letting it to the ports. That was the point I was making, rather than letting it just to the ports to invest, because from a return on investment point, it doesn't make sense. For the region, it makes an awful lot of sense.
I would agree that collaboration with the tourist board is really important, because we don't always see a cohesive approach. And I think sometimes we do forget the number of customers who cruise, but they also stay as part of their package as well. And that's a really important contribution to the economy.
Definitely. I was just going to pick up on that point, you know, especially for you down in Palmer, 20-30%...
20% of our customers would also stay on land as well, so they take a seven-night cruise and a seven-night land-based holiday. And it's becoming an increasingly important way of attracting new-to-cruise guests, so we shouldn't forget about what broader contribution to the countries and ports that we visit.
Francis, you?
Well, I was going to say the same thing. I mean, our business really, you know, is predominantly outside of Spain, for example, is fly cruise. So if you take the passengers out of the UK or Scandinavia or Germany, I think our percentages may be slightly higher than 20% of people that would take at least one or two nights accommodation in the city prior to getting on board the cruise ship. And certainly from North America, you know, they're bolting on seven-night land tours in Spain pre or post the cruise. So, you know, Neil makes a very good point. I think it was well answered too. But, you know, it's got to be collaborative. All of you out there, we need to be able to be speaking as cruise lines, as destinations, tourist boards, as well as the ports. And I think, you know, the economic impact of what we do as cruise lines is far more adhering to any mayor in Barcelona than it would be just standalone.
Well, thanks. I think it was great this morning that, you know, we had tour Spain here. We had the director of the tourism here in Madrid, and she was very enthusiastic about Madrid as a cruise destination. When I tell my colleagues, my boss, that I'm going to Madrid for a cruise conference, he said, "What are you going to Madrid for? There's no port in Madrid, right?" But I think, you know, this is a hub here in Madrid with the airport. A lot of people fly into Madrid to get to Barcelona or to the UK. So, you know, especially Latin American passengers flying to here, because the connections are amazing. So, just while I'm talking about Latin America, maybe Jorge, you can talk a little bit about your experience with Pullmantur down in Latin America, and some of your ships are shifting back to Europe, correct?
That's correct. Well, Latin America, it's been always very important for us. There will always be winter. So, and our Spanish product fits very well for the Latin American market. But we're not seeing the best times in Latin America. We're seeing 30 to 40% devaluation across the region. We're seeing a significant economic slowdown in Brazil with a recession of minus 2%. For this year, if we focus on Brazil, a few years ago there were 22 ships in the Brazilian coast. This year,
seeing eight,
and next year we'll see less. And Latin America has always been the region of the future, and I think it will continue being the region of the future.
Is that good news for Europe then, if you less ships there?
It is very good news for Europe. In our case specifically, we decided to refocus and really concentrate in our core markets of Spain and France. So we're going to enhance our value proposition. We're going to bring more ships to serve the Spanish market. I think there's a big potential there, and also the French market with a much better product.
Excellent. Anybody else want to comment there? Any questions as well? You can tweet away, or ask questions online. Carla?
No, just one thing. I think that these are not good news for anybody that South America is going down, because in the short term, it seems like, okay, come to Europe, come to the Med. But in the long term, if you stimulate the demand there, I'm sure that it will come to Europe. It's, for instance, now in the Med, we are seeing a lot of Australians coming to the Med to take a cruise. And this is thanks, your cruise lines mainly, have stimulated the demand there and put your ships there. So sooner or later they will come. And we are Medcruise. We see the Asian market an opportunity for us. If in a short term it might seem a threat, in the long term, it's something that it has happened. It has happened. Europe compared to the Caribbean, I'm sure that 20 years ago, the Caribbean was a little a threat of the Mediterranean in Europe. And at the end, all of us are benefiting from this. So For us in Medcruise, we are now starting a big campaign, marketing campaign to travel agents to promote the Mediterranean as a cruise destination there, to help the cruise lines to promote this, with the hope that the Asian people, perhaps not the first cruise, perhaps not the second one, but the third one, we are very, very convinced that the Mediterranean offer fits a lot with the Asian preferences.
Perfect. Well, Francis, from your point of view, I mean, you're the sales guy on the panel. Yeah, so from a sales guy's point of view here, and operations as well, VP International Sales. So how do you see it, South America?
Well, we just put a ship back there. So
fingers crossed, Matt.
So we're excited. We haven't been there for a long time. I mean, we're 14 ships in the Norwegian fleet. We've been in South America with Oceania and Region for many, many years. But, you know, utilising those as source markets, and I agree with you with Jorge, that, you know, there are some real issues in South America. You know, opening an office in Brazil this year, in hindsight, was, you know, might have been more of a challenge than we would have typically have expected. But, you know, those markets still do well for us in terms of opening an office location. And the product itself is sourced not just locally, that's the main thing, as an international cruise line, we're not just dependent on the local markets for South America. So we've actually just started our itineraries actually about a week ago, sailing around there. So it's a bit challenging on the pricing side of things, but I think that will pick up. So we're back in South America and very excited to be there.
And Carlos, do you want to make any comment there from the Carnival's point of view?
Well, I think what Carlos said, you know, the fact that it's not doing well is not good. I think it's important that we bring awareness all over the world to cruising. We still are infants in terms of what the leisure market means. But I think that where we see sort of the growth in South America, we're not big South American players year-round at least, but where I see and our company sees potential in the future is maybe home porting in Mexico and being able to get closer to some of the South American ports from the Mexican market and being able to source Mexicans that have a hard time getting travel visas to the United States. So from our perspective, if where I see sort of an explosion happening, it would be sort of that Mexican sourcing, Mexican full import possibility going forward.
Okay. Luis, yeah. Got a question.
Yeah, absolutely. You know, just coming back to George, you know, I also operated in for many years, and you mentioned, you know, the economical, you know, stress that they're having there that is causing the, you know, the demand to pretty much diminish. But there's another factor that I experienced, and I'm just wondering, you know, if you're still having this lengthy bureaucratic and legislative difficulties or confusion sometimes, and if there's any lessons that we can learn from those markets there and from those countries there that can be applied to Europe.
Well, this is an interesting topic, and we could spend hours talking about the way to do business, especially in Brazil. It's a wonderful country with tremendous opportunities, but it's quite complex. And I think the fleet deployed in Brazil is a good example of some of the problems that we are all facing. Actually, we just have one last situation that by year end, the exemption that we have for the international remittances, that today we don't pay taxes, is going to be eliminated. So for every player now in Brazil, it's going to cost us 30% more to send money out of Brazil. If it wasn't complex enough, and now we have another one. So I think it's complex. I think there will always be demand, not only necessarily for cabotage, but also for international operations. There are many things that we can learn from there, but the industry there is less developed than in other regions. So probably we should go the other way around and try to implement there some of the learnings that we have here in Europe or the Caribbean.
Good, thanks. Can I ask a question? And anybody can pick it up. What about Cuba? Cuba's been on the radar. You know, everybody's gearing up for Cuba. Anybody want to pick Cuba? Helen, maybe you actually call it Cuba.
So we've been calling Cuba for a number of years now, and we home port in Jamaica, which gives us access to Cuba. And it's a hugely popular destination for British guests, and is a huge source of business for us. I guess the infrastructure there can be quite challenging. So to turn around in Cuba, I think will present some challenges to the larger cruise lines. But yes, it's a definite interest, and we are going to maximise that before anybody else is visiting regularly. Well, if the facilities were there, that is a consideration. Yeah, definitely.
I think let's stay on this topic about Cuba, because our colleagues from MSC, there's nobody from MSC on the panel. MSC actually home port in Havana, okay, with quite a large ship, a Lyrica class ship as well, nearly 2,000 passengers. It goes seamlessly. I have a lot of experience as well handling. When I worked at Festival, we had two ships based in Havana. We were very brave. Carlos, let's look at you first from Carnival. I'm sure you've had some visits to Cuba, maybe not yourself.
Not one. Look, I think, first of all, there's an embargo for a U.S. company, so we can't go. We can't go there. We have one brand, the Fathom brand, that's going to start in April. Every 2 weeks is going to be doing this people-to-people tourism, which is one of the allowable items or reasons why you can visit Cuba. But it still won't allow the guests that are on that ship, it's only about 710 guests that are on that ship that's going to be coming from Miami, to go and visit family. So when they get off the ship, they're going to do specific tours that are this people-to-people program. They're going to be getting on buses, they're not going to be going in taxis and doing their own thing. They're going to specifically... So it's a very tailored product. So this freedom to explore Cuba beyond the tours that we're doing is still not a possibility. Now, as far as what it means long-term to our industry, fantastic. I mean, from my perspective, it just gives me many more options in terms of the itineraries that we can create from the United States. Clearly, there will be challenges in terms of infrastructure, but I can tell you that when there's opportunities, people fill holes very quickly. So buses, I'm sure there's going to be a lot of buses going there. They'll eventually help with transportation issues. Tours will be created.
Don't forget, all these guys have tourism. Let me tell you, they have better buses in Havana than what we do over
just
here.
Just not enough.
They have quite a few buses.
Yeah.
So they're quite developed on tourism.
For sure. A lot of opportunities.
Yeah. No, there's a lot of opportunities. Okay, you or... Please, yeah. Either of you.
I was just going to say...
Who's maybe, bigger?
Well, larger than me, but... Cuba's very close to the heart of our CEO, Frank Del Rio. He came from Cuba, came over when he was 7 years old. He's very keen to make sure that we go back into Cuba. And I think even last week he commented publicly that Cuba has the potential to be more attractive than China in terms of what it can do for the Caribbean and opening up the Caribbean cruises and actually making it even more attractive for a globally sourced market. So I think we're ready to dust off our itinerary planning, but it's down to legislation. And I think once that comes, you'll see Norwegian Cruise Line Holdings being there. Probably not on a Norwegian ship, but I would imagine that Oceania or a Regent ship would be the first one there.
Okay. Looking at Jorge, I mean, Jorge, you used to have ships from Pullmantur in the old days based in Havana also, but then you were taken over by American colleagues,
right.
So you couldn't call any longer. How do you see it?
Well, we see definitely Cuba in the Royal Group as a tremendous opportunity within the Caribbean. I wouldn't place it close to China, but I think it's going to be big in the Caribbean, definitely. There are many places that can be visited. There's an infrastructure issue today, but definitely it will be big. We're also working on our people-to-people program. We want to be there. But we're thrilled with the development, with the speed that everything is taking place in Cuba. So we'll be there soon, definitely.
Perfect. Okay, I think we've got about 15 minutes left, and I just want to try and change a little bit. Just ask a question to the audience. From what you've heard, yeah, Juan Madrid's got a question. Juan, you need a mic there, please.
Well, it's not a question, it's a clarification. Because three of you on the panel were talking about the new Barcelona mayor. And then I have to clarify three things. So, because she now is learning about cruises, she contacted us as consultants to increase their knowledge about the cruise industry. So she is not against of the cruises, this is clear, and she clarifies this. He also clarifies that their declarations in the New York Times were manipulated, so he's complaining about this. That she's worried about the movement already existing in Barcelona, not against the cruises, against the tourism in general. So
that's a big opportunity for other major cities in Europe then, if she's worried about that, no? Because Barcelona is surviving tourism, no?
The municipality is trying to, let's say, organize or reorganize or keep an eye on the flows. So the question is how to reduce the notions of the citizens. Because in the zones of the city where there are touristical buildings or places, so the neighborhood is absolutely complicated to survive for the local citizens. So the municipality now is learning fast. So we have had with them.
Those are good problems.
These are fantastic problems.
Which Lord Mayor would not want these sort of problems? And may I just start with Carla, where I think the professor's going to talk about Barcelona after. But, you know, there's 2.5 million cruise passengers, roughly, in Barcelona this year. How many tourists were in Barcelona this year? Not cruise, FIT passengers. Who came into Barcelona on vacation?
More than 6 million.
Right, okay. So cruise is a small part. So maybe we need to look. You built a new airport to handle more traffic. I don't think it's still at capacity yet. So, you know, if you were investing in a new airport to compete with Madrid, okay, you're going to have to expect an influx of tourists. And I agree with you. Yeah, and I think it's something that needs managing. But I think it's a great problem to have too many tourists rather than too less tourists. So, thank you for the question.
No, but only one more thing. But as far as the cruises, in the cruise industry, we know in Barcelona about 2 years before ahead. Where the ship is coming, which size of the ship, how many passengers are there, the municipality is trying to study or to create a kind of coordination with the port authority and the tourist authorities, how to move the cruise passengers, because it's really a small part of the total tourism.
Carl just mentioned it before, coming on Tuesday, Wednesday and Thursday. It would eliminate some issues. Maybe we should leave it there, because I know we've got the next session. We've got about 10 minutes left. I'd like to move into part two and just talk a little bit about the ships, okay? Because, you know, it's interesting for everybody out there. The ships are getting bigger. The port infrastructure, I know Mike McCarthy mentioned earlier, ports in Northern Europe are doing great. Ports in the UK have always done really well with it. And I think here in Spain, congratulations to everybody, the Spanish Port Authority have done an excellent job in terms of that. But the size of the ships, Francis, maybe I look at you. You just brought another big ship out. You've got your largest ship here in Barcelona. I mean, is size always better, or?
How do I answer that one? you know, the ships, I think now, as I said, I think earlier on one of the earlier questions, they got to a point now where I think, you know, from our perspective, and I'll talk just to the Norwegian brand, is, you know, they're the optimal size for us now in terms of the way that we operate our freestyle cruising program. So I think, you know, anybody who's seen the ship, it's about 164,000 tons, 4,200 guests at our berth. That for us is probably the optimal size. I can't foresee us building any ships bigger than that in the future, but who knows? But I think that for us is the way that we like to operate our program.
Okay. I'm smiling and looking at Neil smiling away. He's building two huge ships with Costa and with Aida as well, so plus that space. What about you, Carlos? How many of your ships?
You know, our biggest concern is not putting this huge amount of pressure on the nautical side. So for instance, his two new ships, they're not necessarily that much longer. So it's not like what Oasis did and the Allure did in terms of the demands on the ports. I mean, we clearly understand that, you know, your issues in terms of these investments. So we build ships that can hopefully get into most of the ports that are out there now in terms of depth, in terms of length. Where we see some pressures is obviously these ships are becoming more dense with people. So for instance, you know, you're talking about 6,000 guests getting off a ship, there's going to have to be some consideration given to facilities off the ship, transportation, just managing this huge amounts of people. So I would put a lot more focus on the land side, not necessarily on the sort of maritime side. However, with that said, for instance, these two ships are going to have LNG, so there's going to have to be some consideration given there in terms of how to fuel these ships. These are things that the ports need to go and speak to the cruise lines, because each individual cruise line may have something unique that they may have in terms of demands, and it's important to have that dialogue.
Is that something, Mike, you might want to pick up LNG? Are you LNG ready? Or?
Not at the moment. But again, there is an onus on ports under the EU directive to be able to, as Herman said, receive waste and supply LNG. Now, the supply of LNG as a bunker fuel is one issue, but you know, rather than building very, very expensive infrastructure, you know, there could be a collaboration between ports in supplying LNG by barge or by bunkering barge or bunkering ship, etc. So there, from the marine side, we're confident, and most of our ports are confident that, you know, we can comply and we can supply it. And I think most of the major turnaround ports in Northern Europe are ahead of the curve in the facilities to do that.
Helen, you was worried LNG.
Just,
I mean, are you worried about LNG? I'm not worried about LNG, but
I guess we see operating smaller ships as an opportunity. Clearly, we don't benefit from the economies of scale as you do operating the much larger vessels. But what operating smaller ships gives us is an opportunity to go into much smaller ports where some of these bigger ships can't go to. And the passenger experience, which is hugely important to us, is much easier in those smaller ports. So for us, it does give us a point of differentiation in the UK market.
Okay, thanks. Jorge, you want to just pick up from, say, a Royal Caribbean point of view? Because you've just built another Oasis class ship, right? Is that as big as they're going to get?
Well, we're thrilled with the results with Oasis and with Quantum. But I agree with Carlos on his point regarding the limitations more on the land side. I mean, you cannot bring an Oasis class ship everywhere. And as you can see, we have more Quantum class coming into the market. So we believe there should stay somewhere around that size. We don't foresee bigger ships in the near future coming.
150,000, 60,000 tons. Small, no, Michael. What?
No, I think Helen made a very important point that there are approximately 25 brands operating over 100 ships that are small to medium sized ships, and you know 60% of the members of Cruise Europe are in that field. That's the market that they're in. They're not in the mega ships. They're not in the big ships. And a lot of the ports, in addition to providing just the ship berthing space, it's very important that we create in the ports a memory, a lasting memory. Guests want to do something that, you know, they want to have a good experience of the region. They want seamless logistics. The port is only the one link, as we've heard previously. So, you know, for the challenge for the ports as well in the landside operation is to make that visit and make those passengers feel special. And I think it's very, very important from our members' point of view that we don't lose sight of the small ship operator, the boutique operator, and that's where a lot of our members are focusing their attention on it, because you know it just does not make sense for them to build the type of infrastructure that's required.
Okay. I think just talking then, just to move it over a little bit, about the port infrastructure, it'd be interesting to hear you know, your point of views here in Europe, here in the Med. Yeah, and please be honest, because this is a great audience we've got. None of them are asking questions, so you must be all doing such a great job and answering all their questions. Please feel free to tweet away. I want to ask the audience a question. Please go onto your machines, yeah, and just vote, please, yeah, how positive you guys are with the Mediterranean after what you're hearing. If you are positive as a group, as a port group, here at the Cruise Summit, if you are positive about the Mediterranean, it'll just be interesting to see what the audience views are. So, if we can carry on, just to talk about infrastructure, my colleague Juan Madrid mentioned earlier the challenges in Barcelona. there are challenges in many of the port cities. How do you think we should handle this as a group? What are the fundamental things, maybe, Carlos, that you guys learnt in the Caribbean? You know, how did you work to combat this?
So, not to beat up on you, but you know, I think Neil's point is right. Every port that we go to has a challenge. You know, there's this sort of private ownership of the port and sort of the commercial nature of why they were there. And most of these ports, that's the originating business. But at the same time, you also have to understand that the governments and the citizens of those destinations look at the port as sort of the entry for economic prosperity. And so it's sort of a responsibility on that side. But then, should it be all shouldered by you? Should it all be shouldered by the port? And my answer is no. I think there needs to be sort of this group discussion on how to develop these ports and sort of, you know, kind of look to other authorities to help you with the infrastructure, because what you do on cruise is single purpose, peak demand, certain times of the week, within certain hours. So it's not like you have other reasons why to invest those money. So it sort of has to be sort of like a, you know, communal discussion in terms of how to support the
infrastructure. Can I stop you there? Because you guys can't see it, but 70% of our colleagues in front of us believe that there's a positive outlook for the Mediterranean. So that is really good news. Really, really good news. And 30% believe there isn't a future for the Mediterranean. Okay, we will see you after a coffee and you can tell us why you think that. Yeah, 30% of you are really worried about the Mediterranean.
Actually, why don't you ask the question? What's the worry? Is the worry that the business isn't growing enough?
I think it's positive. Okay, I mean, you're bringing ships back.
Yeah, I think we need to differentiate between West Med and East Med, because most of the people here are probably focused on the West Med, and I see a brilliant future for the West Med. And we find tremendous infrastructure. I mean, here in Spain, you look at all these ports with such a great infrastructure, with such a great support for this industry, and we're quite happy and thankful for that. But on the other side, on the East Med, let's take Greece, for instance, Santorini, you know, one of these places, the challenges in terms of infrastructure are tremendous. So probably, I mean, if we only focus on the West, the results are much different than East Med.
I could not agree more. I think the West Med has got a great future. There's great itineraries, there's iconic sites. You can, you know, even in the winter, let's talk the Canary Islands as well. I know it's not Med. You know, we class it as part of that cluster. So you can do so many exciting things in the West Med, Canary Islands, you know, France, Italy. I think
we shouldn't forget places like Montenegro, and because places like that and that coastline, there's huge potential there, and we see that as a great opportunity as well.
I think you guys mentioned you based a ship in Croatia this year for the first time.
We've been in Dubrovnik, yeah, and it's hugely popular. It's one of those destinations that our customers want to stay. We're extending to have overnight stays next year, but we do see the Dalmatian coast driving potential, Montenegro, Slovenia. We've visited Albania this year, so I think there is a huge opportunity, and there is potential in some of those ports of call as well.
What about, Francis, the opportunity for some of the smaller ports? How do you see the smaller ports? What do they need to do to convince you, not with the Norwegian Epic, but with the Norwegian Star, something different to...
Well, I think it's quite exciting for us because, you know, I think since Frank came into the organisation, he's very...
Frank Del Rio.
He's very... keen on making sure that we continue to look at what we're doing with ports. He's personally involved in a lot of the itinerary planning that goes on across the three brands. I think we do a lot of smaller ports on the Oceania region brands that are different to obviously provide excitement to those destinations, to those itineraries. It's slightly more tricky with the Norwegian brand, which is much more contemporary and more in the mass market arena. But I think we're starting to see, even on some of the developments in South America, we're already starting to make some inroads in terms of Europe, in terms of looking to add new ports and new destinations. So I think the future for the smaller ports from our brand perspective, I think, looks pretty rosy. And I think it's an exciting time. I think one point I would comment on some of the other things is And I think Carlos's point is about making sure that we minimise the from a port perspective some of the pier side tasks, if that makes sense, to and move some of these things quicker. So that's one of the issues that we face in terms of embarkation and disembarkation. So, you know, making sure that, you know, credit cards and maybe photo IDs, these things can be done more pre-cruise. Clearly we need security at ports, clearly we need passport and visa checks and things like that, but I think passing customers through the ports in a quicker manner is definitely key to the cruise line. So again, to all the ports out there, big or small, I think that's something that, you know, investment in technology is key.
Great. Can I just comment on the small ports?
We've got 5 minutes maximum.
Just one minute. So. I think, you know, I always get the question, what can we do to get more business as a small port? Or we're not really considered as part of itinerary. You know, these are the kind of things that I hear. And I think that there needs to be a little responsibility on the ports themselves to do a little bit of homework. And really, the easiest way to figure out how you fit into the overall picture is figure out what are the ships you want to go after. What are the home ports where they're starting from? And look at the existing itineraries that they're on and figure out, just do your own sort of itinerary planning and look to see, okay, if I suggest to this company that they add this particular port, maybe they don't have to drop another one, or maybe they can add another one, add value to the itinerary. So this is the kind of feedback that we as cruise lines, who are thinking about all sorts of things, you guys are thinking about your one port. So it's important to be in front of the cruise lines with the homework and say, this is how I suggest we add more value to your company by adding XYZ ports to your itineraries.
Well, you're in Hamburg as well. Quite a few of you are in Hamburg. I mean, some of us attended the Clear European Summit. My colleague Bo is somewhere out there. He's going to be moderating. We did an excellent exercise at Clear where we played a game in groups at tables and started planning itineraries. Oh my God! Yeah, I was. I'm not going to name the person from a large cruise line. I was an itinerary planner, and he got it hopelessly wrong as well. It's not easy planning an itinerary. So I think the ports out there, you know, like Carlos mentioned, you've got to tell them. But you study those itineraries yourselves, yeah, and see how fast the ships need to go. How many other ships are going to be around that day? Yeah. So I think it's important that you guys. Or look at that. I'm conscious of time. I think it's gone really, really well. But I'd just like to ask you all one last question. And please be honest, just briefly,